This is Beelink's new Mini S. It's a Jasper Lake mini PC that's aimed at just basic computing. So people that just want, well, emails, documents, spreadsheets, social media, and video playback, those kind of tasks, it's actually all right at. So it is powered by a Celeron N5095. It's a quad-core chip, maximum turbo is 2.8 gigahertz, and it is all running Windows 11, of course, with this model. Now, 8 gigabytes of RAM is not a lot, but it should be sufficient for light computing, and it does have a 256 gigabyte SATA 3 SSD. You can add more storage to this because there is room, even though it's very small and compact, as you can see, fits in the palm of my hand, a 2.5 inch drive. So that could be an SSD or a spindle hard drive with higher capacity, say 2 terabytes for all your video collection. It does have gigabit LAN and can run 2 4K monitors. It has 4 USB 3 ports. So I'll let you know, is it worthwhile considering something so low powered here? But it does have a good price point, of course, for those that don't want to spend a lot of money. It does come in this very small box, and you'll see the mini PC there is just tiny. Now they include some screws here for the VESA mount bracket. We do get 2 HDMI cables, so a longer one, and then a shorter one. So the short one you'd use if you're going to be just VESA mounting it, that's why they do that. And then this is our power supply here, and it is rated to a max of 36 watts. It does have a great little compact size, as you can see. So with ports, we've got 2 USB 3s, gigabit LAN, 2 HDMI 2.0s there, so that's 4K 60, DCN, Kensington lock slot, and it is actively cooled. So a little fan's gonna be pushing the hot air out the back where this little vent is right there. So vents on the left, vents on the right. There is no micro SD card reader with this, unfortunately, or SD card reader. They've got a little button there to clear the CMOS, another 2 USB 3.0 ports, and then we've got the combo slot there, sorry, jack for 3.5 millimeter with our power on button. On the underside, there are 4 rubber feet, and if you remove those 4 screws, you can gain access to the internals. Now, a little tip here, to get the back off is rather tricky, but where these 2 holes are, that's for the VESA mounting bracket, simply insert your screwdriver and then pull up on that, and you'll find that that lid will end up coming off. Now, when you open it up, be a little bit careful because there is a ribbon cable attached to it. And there you'll see we do have room for upgrades. So we've got only the single slot sewed in there, so it's only going to be in single channel, unfortunately. So yes, you could add 16 gigabytes to this to increase the RAM capacity. You can see this is where you can add a 2.5 inch drive. So that can be a spindle or an SSD if you want a little bit more speed. And it does have a thermal pad on here, which connects up to the SATA 3 M.2 drive we have. The Wi-Fi card, you can just see it here. It's soldered onto the motherboard, so there's no upgrades in that department. And it is the Intel 3165, so that's wireless AC. We don't have the faster wireless AX with this model. So RAM can be swapped out, SSD can be swapped out, and you can add a 2.5 inch drive. Not bad, but it's just missing that dual channel RAM, unfortunately. Very quickly, I'll show you the BIOS. So it is completely unlocked, and no, it wouldn't normally be jumping around like this. I don't know why it's bouncing up and down. That's something to do with my capture card. It doesn't like the resolution of it. So everything there is unlocked. There's a lot of settings that you can potentially mess up, cause problems. That's probably why they do include that reset the CMOS little switch there too that is on it. So let's jump into Windows. The Mini S does have 8 gigabytes, but you don't get the full 8 gigabytes because a tiny bit is dedicated to the Intel UHD graphics, and that is the 16 executional units that it does have here with the Jasper Lake. Now, it is Windows 11 Pro that it does run. Now, that's a bit of a surprise. I was expecting it to be Windows 11 Home just because it's a slightly cheaper license there, so that's good in a way. Now, the start menu, just bring that up. It sometimes can be a little laggy, so it's not a powerhouse of a chipset. We already know this. It is just for basic computing here, basic Windows 11 computing, like spreadsheets, documents, very easy kind of stuff here. So the RAM, I just wanted to check on this to confirm that it is running at 2667 megahertz. But as I pointed out before, when we looked at the internals, it's just the single stick. So that means that we are missing out on that dual channel bandwidth, which means that it's not going to be quite as fast as it could be. And the most part that is affected from this is actually the graphics from that bandwidth there. So that's just what it is. They didn't obviously have room to use that. So looking under our CPU here, which is the Celeron, the N5095, you can see that is a 15 watt part here. And our power limit level 2 is 30 watts. Now, the BIOS is completely unlocked. You could, I believe, go and increase this. Hopefully, that does take. May aid in boosting the performance a little, but you will definitely get higher thermals and slightly louder because the fan's going to have to work a little harder. And I'll cover the fan noise and the thermals later on in this review. That SSD, you can get reasonable speeds out of it for SATA 3. I mean, it's not too far off from peak performance, which would be 550 reads and write sequentials there. And we do have approximately 206 gigabytes free on first boot. Now remember, you can install a 2.5-inch drive. So you can install a spindle one or an SSD to increase the capacity and storage, or even swap out this boot drive altogether. Now, other performance figures here, I'm not going to go into a lot here, just Geekbench 5, okay? So you can see the single core score there, multi-score, does tell us that this, yes, is very low end. So it's for basic computing, and I really want to stress that this is not for AAA titles, gaming-wise. It's not for editing 4K videos, because you will be extremely disappointed. It is a, well, $200 or so mini PC, so you can only expect so much. Now, the performance of playback of demanding video files. Let's have a look at that, because Windows can be very funny. Even on Core i7 machines, you sometimes get a few stutters in the beginning. So this one is 4K, 60 frames per second. You can see it is slow to load in, and it is dropping frames. Now, that should be running a little bit faster, but now it's picking up, okay? There we go. Oh, and there's some big stutters there as well. So it's not too happy about that one. It's just finding it too demanding, 60 frames per second. The same goes for streaming YouTube, 4K 60, you're going to drop frames there. But what about 4K 10-bit HEVC? Now, this is native decoding, the initial stutters, which always seem to happen with Windows, and then it's fine, okay? So it can play these files at 4K 30, but 4K 60, no, doesn't like it. Continuing on with that topic of 4K video, this is YouTube here, and I'm going to attempt to stream just some 4K 30 frames per second. So let's enable our stats here. Now, you're probably going to see some dropped frames because my connection is quite poor. And as it's running, buffer health is actually okay at the moment. And it is continually just dropping a few frames there and here and there. But will it still be viewable? That's the main thing, of course, that we want. So you can see there. It is noticeable. I can see those drop frames there. My buffer health is about to run out too. So not amazing performance there, but I guess you could call that, it's kind of watchable, but it's just those occasional just drop frames causing a few little stutters in there, which is a little annoying when it comes to streaming with YouTube. Crime performance. So it's something that a lot of people do ask me on these lower spec of mini PCs or tablets or laptops that I review with Jasper Lake. So I'm just going to search here cats and we'll see how long it takes to open up. You can see I have to accept all of this first because I actually have not run this and nothing is going to be cached. Now, I don't want to go too crazy here, but I will open up quite a few tabs and we'll see. How is it going to perform? Now, memory, I still have quite a bit left, so that's okay. With the 8 gigabytes, you can generally normally run about 10 to 15 tabs or so. The only thing is that when you do open up a lot, as you see now, it is starting to affect the performance. Now, the CPU is not at 100% yet with its quad cores, maximum turbo is 2.8, but it's getting very close. So it is slowing down a little now, and I'll just swap between these tabs because they are going to take a while to load. Okay, so that one, the scrolling there is fine, but there we go. We're peaking now at CPU performance at 100%. So swapping between these tabs, the ones that have loaded in here, you can see it's not too fast, but there is a noticeable bit of delay between them. So that's a very light page there. So Wikipedia, let's go through some of these others. Okay, that's still loading in there. GitHub, that's easy enough. So it's all right. So once you just go at a normal kind of reading pace and having a lot of different tabs open for these kind of light tasks, it is fine, this spec. So you'll not really have too much of an issue. It's just when you really push it hard, decide to open up like 30, 25, 20 tabs, 15 tabs, you can run into then the memory restrictions, especially with Chrome here. And onto our gaming performance. So this is Counter-Strike, and we'll take a look at the Dust 2 map here. Now I've got it set to 720p, lowest possible settings, and we'll see if it's actually going to be playable or not. Okay, so we're looking around 30 frames per second just at 720p here. Probably with smoke grenades and whatnot, action going on screen, and flame grenade like now, yeah, it is dipping down a little bit, so not amazing. Yeah, it's gone under 30 frames per second now, so I'm just going to charge in. Ooh, enemies. Charge in, and yeah, probably just die straight away, but that's not the idea. My gameplay is just to take a quick, oh, there we go, dead. Trying to take a quick look at the performance there, so you can see that for these older titles, yeah, you're going to get just at 720p, just over 30 frames per second, but you probably actually want to run something like 800 times 600 and really just stick to these older titles. That's all that's going to be playable on this Intel UHD graphics. And really quick here, because it is shaking up and down with my capture card. So Linux Mint, I did test it out. Everything does work, but for some reason, I can't seem to change to a higher resolution. So a little bit of tweaking needed, but you shouldn't have any issues running Linux on this type of mini PC. And what about our thermals then? So it did reach 87 degrees Celsius. That little fan in it is quite hard to hear most of the time, so you really need to put your ear up to it, and then, okay, yeah, you can hear that there's a fan in there. So good fan noise, and it doesn't run into thermal throttling because of that fan. It's only a 15 watt part, but if it was passively cooled, it would overheat. So it does offer, I think for the price, the basic computing needs that most people will be after. For things like, of course, like Chrome, checking your emails, video playback, YouTube, maybe a bit of Netflix, things like that. Basic kind of computing needs. This is what a spec like this is perfectly fine for. And if you wanted to use it as a video media player kind of system, then it will be okay for that as well too, there with a native playback of VP9 and HEVC. However, it didn't like 4K 60. Streaming or playback, it was choppy, so I don't really recommend it for that because it's not ideal performance there. So there's really only one thing I can fault for the price that this does sell for, and that is that it's only running single channel RAM, so they didn't have enough space inside here to have this two SODIMM slots, which would have been ideal. If we could add another stick, that would have been perfect there, but sadly we don't. But we do have the option to add more storage with that 2.5 inch bay, which is really good to see. So thank you so much for watching my review here of Beelink's Mini S, an affordable Windows 11 Pro Mini PC.